change of the current scene in India. Have you seen anything different in your tenure as a band? Are you seeing, you know, in terms of people coming to concerts, people buying original music and merchandise?
Yes, of course.
So is there an increase in that?
Yes,
definitely.
See, right now, the crisis of intent is solved.
Right.
People have the intent. Mm-hmm. The crisis on that.
Okay.
The intent itself is not there. So right now, the intent has arrived. But what has not arrived is how much is the right value to translate that intent into something more tangible.
Yeah.
I want to buy your CD. How much will you buy my CD for? This is a question yet to be answered. Same appeals for merchandise. So what has happened is, like, right now everybody who turns up actually will say that, okay, if it is affordable for me and if there's a way I can buy it easily, I have the intention to buy it. So that is a quantum leap. That's a massive leap.
And this wasn't there 4 years.
It was not there 4 years primarily because the access was hard. Right? Like, you had to go to a planet. You had to walk into a music world,
right,
and then stand in the line and get it and built
need,
and take
you
it
home. Need to be big to have your CD player.
Right.
So
getting your box.
It's really difficult for a band, like a small band, to actually get their CD up there in the second row of music world of Canada.
Right.
Now there are many more avenues where you can actually reach out to a fan, reach out to somebody to give the CD and he's able to take the CD.
Then the internet happened.
Yeah.
Then piracy happened in a very big way.
Yeah.
Where, you know, even the remaining intent was killed because the guys who were selling were actually selling at really dishonest prices.
Mm.
Like, you know, 450 rupees for a really crappy sort of an album was selling at like 500 rupees. So naturally the buying behavior kind of turned liberalistic because what you're putting out there is like really useless. It doesn't even require my attention, but still I'm doing you a charity by actually bootlegging it or pirating it.
Mm-hmm.
So the guy who was actually pirating it had a morally high ground because you are a ripoff. Like, you know, your work does not cost that much money.
Yeah.
Considering the fact that you are a dishonest ripoff, I'm going to give it back to you
by
whipping you off. This is real. This is what was happening. I have done that myself. Openly on camera, I've done that myself. I really like the music. Really? That is like two songs in that album is really nice. I'm not going to buy a 12-piece album at 500 rupees because you have like two nice songs in it. Then the singles happened in India.
Yeah.
You could sell singles. Then the River Nations of the world happened. Then the band camps happened. More recently, the flight happened. Okay, doesn't happen.
SoundCloud
happened. Yeah. Like, a lot of things happened on the internet. YouTube happened. Like, you know, YouTube was a bloody big deal.
Yeah.
All these things happened, and then all of a sudden, like, you know, the young buyers of this country started comparing price of music to stuff that they actually consume. So I personally keep using this analogy of, like, saying that's cheaper than a beer that you're having right now.
Yeah,
so I keep using that, and sometimes somebody with like a pretty high sense of humor or a pretty low sense of humor, I don't want to judge that, would say, I don't drink beer. Like, fair. God, that was funny, but
he'll come up with the cost.
Yeah, I don't know which way. So if you have that attitude, it's like really hard. But when I'm trying to say, like, you know, it actually costs you like less than two packs of cigarettes, it actually means it doesn't cost you much.
Right.
So that on a whole increases that crisis of confidence itself gone. Like, you know, oh, he's selling it at 10 rupees a piece, 20 rupees a piece. I really like that song, and 20 bucks is nothing.
Mm.
And that increases your probability of wanting to support somebody.
Right.
Like, you know, see, that wanting to support somebody comes from a trust that you make from the guy who does not know you. So there are a lot of people who will actually write to me that, please put out your album, I want to buy it.
I keep hearing that
all the while, all of us keep hearing that. The people are dropping us even, I don't want an MP3, I want to buy it. The people even who walked up and said, I don't want to buy it digitally, I really want to
buy it
physical CD. That is a huge improvement in our ecosystem because that intention has come very strong.
And there are ways to
support that. Right. So the other side is also happening. Beautiful point. The other side is also happening.
Right.
Now somebody is wanting to buy, you can actually supply it, like with the Flipkarts and with the Oculus and the Amazons and the iTunes of the world. The supply problem is also handled.
Yeah.
So I am like really hoping that the young people of this country who actually realize that, you know, they need to support or they need to buy. See, when I go to US like for work, the de facto thing is you buy music.
Mm-hmm.
They don't even speak downloading music. So we are a little behind on that. We still speak downloading music, but probably in 5 years, in 5 years, I hope like all of us start saying, oh, I like that song, let's buy it.
Yeah.
So that's where we should reach, but honestly, we were courageous enough to put out an album today, like yesterday was an album launch. One reason what gave us the confidence and strength to actually put out an album, producing it, was that we believed people would buy it.
How many
would buy it, we do not know.
But
we are very sure people are going to buy it. So, answering your question, we have come that far.
Sure. So, you have a great social media platform. I mean, your fan on Facebook. Who's managing it?
All of us.
You have a specific strategy that you have in mind? 8,000 fans. You know, where is that coming from?
It's a small number, to be honest here. I mean, it's
for a niche like Carnatic Progressive Rock.
Yeah,
that is a decent number.
That's a decent number. It's a decent number. I mean, to be honest, it's a decent number. And in Facebook, if we remember, right, we started that page somewhere back in 2010. Be honest, before the first gig that we went up, we had like 69 people in that.
Yeah.
We already had 69 people in that. They didn't know what that is. So
well, like just random people.
Not random people. I just put out like, you know, Ayush created this page. Like,
no, there was a guy whose name was Agam, so he liked the page.
You're all sorts of people who come in liking this page. Like, you know, there was, I mean, so we had like 69 people. We didn't know who they were. And there was like really no activity. We played the first game. So what we did, to be honest, again, it has worked for us in the past, and it's also sort of working for us is that when we went and played when we got the first real place, venue called Kaira in Indra, Bangalore, it's now defunct, but it was like a really nice venue there. Me, Ganesh, and Vicky Kanchan, we went and kept knocking the door for a very, very long time. And finally, we were allowed, like, allowed is the word. They didn't want us or anything. They said, okay, you've come here for so long, I'm going to give you a show. So what we did is, we went to conventional, which is calling and emailing every single entity that we knew in the city. Literally like how a cold calling call center would acquire people. There was no social media, there was none. We were actually lifting our respective phones and calling everybody who like remotely met. Like even to shameless extent that I hadn't spoken to them for 3 years, I would call it. So what transpired is that we would have reached like some 600 people. Call and email as many people. Email probably even more. Like, and said one very simple thing. We are playing our first ever show.
Yeah.
Real show. And we would want you to come.
Right.
And it would cost you 150 rupees to enter. This is the message that each one of us gave out. And in that 1,000 odd people that we reached, 200 people turned up. Most of them turned up because we called them, we kind of pestered them, we wrote emails to them. Many of them even turned up by singing, this is bordering desperation, so I'm gonna go. Yes, it was bordering desperation. I'm not saying it was bordering desperation, because that's the only way we knew at the point in time, because there was no real social media presence. I had like really few friends on Facebook, and but what we did after that was sort of nice, if I'm allowed to say so.
Right.
So, 100, the 200 people who turned, we made sure that we got their coordinates. We just put a white A4 sheet outside the venue. On their way out, we just requested them, please drop your email with us. And we said there's a Facebook page called Agam the Band, fb.me/AgamTheBand. It takes 1 minute for you to go and like it. That gig was really nice. We did a very good job playing that gig. We played very honestly, we played a very tight, nice gig. So a lot of people sort of liked that. And that call to action was answered. Like people didn't, surprisingly, people have a lot of reservations giving email on their forms.
Right.
But interestingly, a lot of people have no qualms writing their email on paper. You would see that behavior in a lot of restaurants where they actually show the sheet. You can ask yourself, you would have written your email.
Absolutely.
Without thinking too much. But the same thing when I throw you a web form, you would think I'm going to spam you. Somehow, our psyche works in a way that if it is on a hard copy, the likelihood of somebody spamming you is a lot lower because somebody has to convert that into soft copy and then spam you.
Right.
This is a mind thing. So that mind thing sort of worked really well for us. People thought, oh, this is not very harmful. I'm just writing my email to him and most likely he's not going to email.
Right.
So, and even the same way the Facebook auto transfer is just a like. Like, you know, and I can always run. Like, Facebook has that beauty.
Mm-hmm.
If you're getting too spam, at that point there was no hiding feature.
Mm-hmm.
You're like or you're not like.
Yeah.
So, what happened is, like, that is that. And This email is a beautiful thing. So we got the email. We actually created a nice mailer for the next year, Oktoberfest,
yeah,
in New York, 2010. So we just created like one Photoshop template. We took another. We are playing Oktoberfest. You came at Kaira. We are the same guys.
Mm-hmm.
And sent an email. I think 30 people came from that list. The moment you actually write an email to a guy with his first name,
that's it.
He's at least going to reply. No, I mean, you at least feel nice. So very simple thing, like, you know, as much as personalization possible, create a mailer than sending plain text.
Right.
Kind of make it a little more like, you know, that you're putting some effort in inviting him rather than throwing him like a blind, dumb email. Oh, I'm playing this week, show up.
Right.
Nobody's going to like that. So, like, you know, make it a little more personal. So what happened is it started, and then we started getting this festival gigs.
Right.
And then we started pushing. So, and then we started getting college gigs. In college gigs, you know, you can be a bit of a bully.
Okay.
They're like really liking your gig, so you ask questions like, how many of you have a smartphone over here? Kids are like really glad they do. How many of you have data connection on this? Like, another 300 put your hands up. I want you to hit fb.p/agamdulat right now and hit this button. Do it now. And I'm going to count from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You know what?
They actually do. Yeah.
They actually do.
Interesting.
It is just the mo- they are actually having a good time. They like you. Oh, if they don't like you, they're gonna own you. I'm talking about situations where they actually like you. They're not like you. They're actually gonna throw that thing at you. So I mean, make no mistake here. So when they're actually jiving to you and you say, they're gonna do this. And then we started putting out quality recordings of our work on the Facebook page, and again did the same circle of asking people to share it. And then big deals happened. Like, you know, went for Storm Festival, big gig.
Yeah.
We played the Mad Festival, again, a super big gig. And then we played the buff of them on, like the Coke Street on MTV. So those are big ticket platforms. Like, I mean, you nail it, people are going to come back to you. People are going to search and find who you are.
Yeah.
Right, you know. So we got lucky in certain ways. So we got the right breaks at some of those critical junctures of our career.
So, you know, what are the, typical targets for a band, like, you know, if the business you have for this quarter, I make this much revenue and all that. What is it for a band, and more specifically, what is it for another?
It goes musically, right? You try to write a song, you want to put out new music. It goes in terms of the song, how many people like this song.
Yeah.
You work on what needs to go into the song. Those are the targets that you have.
Actually, your goals that you set for yourself actually change as you grow as a band. So initially it's about writing music. Without music, you can't go anywhere.
Hmm.
I mean, when you're doing original music, so you need to write some songs.
Right.
At least three,
right,
or four. At least to open to a decent band, you need to have three or four songs.
Right.
That's your initial
first
goal,
target.
Right?
Right.
Then it's about getting gigs, your own gigs. You're not opening to others. You are actually playing your own gigs.
Okay.
You need to have 10 songs then. You need to have 10
songs
to play one other gig.
That is that goal, but there is this additional goal of getting more gigs.
Right.
So you need to bridge the gap. So you make more songs.
You need both.
And you can't just go and play some random song. You need to make a song that actually looks, somebody should hear the song, like it, and then come back for the next gig. It's not like,
so it's like a gig song.
So that is the upward spiral.
Correct.
And then there's a point where, like, you know, now these days we say three paid gigs for sure happen. It has to happen.
Okay. No.
Three paid. If there are four free gig inquiries, you will have to revisit those four inquiries if you have not done three paid gigs, because then you are bleeding off your
pocket.
Right.
So initially probably you would accept it because it's an avenue for you to play.
Mm.
Now
that
you have
music,
some
yeah.
avenues to play, now that you are meeting that goal, now you need to think of monetizing.
Is that like the scaling phase, right?
Yeah, it's a scaling.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you one small thing about music, goal. It's very specific to art, is that art is a very state of mind driven thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, like it or not, many people's state of mind depends upon what sort of stability you have with respect to what you're doing. Financially crippled, do not know how to pay my next electricity bill because I have not paid any of you that pays me, will not let you write good music. It will be really difficult for you to, or you can actually write angsty post-punk.
Exactly, yeah.
If that is your style,
mm-hmm.
just a punk rock band who's like fighting against a society kind of band, it might work, but we are a happy, cheerful, like, you know, entertainment sort of band. It does not help us write songs when we are struggling to figure out ways to actually pay bills, or, like, you know, get our travel tickets booked when somebody is not paying and things like that. So there are targets. Every band has to arrive at that. And some of the DIY bands, like people who don't have full-time jobs, they reach that inflection point a lot faster than me.
Much faster.
They reach that much faster than that. That's why their struggle is bigger than our struggle. And that's also the reason why we have a tremendous amount of respect for guys, because they hit that spiral before they knew they are made it.
Okay.
I know. See, we have a little more breathing space because there is money coming in some other way. Like, you know, we don't do it, but we can do it. There's a choice. When you don't have that choice, you hit that bam at like the second or third moment of reception, and then you're on, and you have to make that money. How are you?
And then when someone asks you to do a cover, when you don't want to do a cover, and ask you to do a
don't say that.
Yeah. A medley of old Hindi songs sung by a particular artist, you have to do it.
Correct. So that realization, that's a terrible realization that kind of hits you, and a lot of guys fall apart.
Mm. You're all exceptional musicians, you know. And
thank you.
I mean that.
Yeah. He's trying to boost your ego.
He's taking it there.
And possibly one of the toughest, jobs is probably a manager who's managing talent. You know, like talent under him. So how have you guys done it? Do you have somebody, a mentor, like figure?
I think we are friends.
Yeah, is that the reason? There is no manager.
Yeah.
It's just a band of friends. And
I think we are friends.
Yeah.
I think we being friends beyond music. Like, you know, music is one of the things that we do as friends.
Yeah, yeah.
We're probably watching movies together, probably,
eating out for dinner.
And also the fact that, spending so... going to the same college, playing to the same club, and hanging out together for so long, doing things, also helps us understand who is good at what. And when you're friends, you tend to forgive your friends for their quirks, right? If you're not friends with someone, you will tend to see them more often.
So us being friends, we know what is happening on others' mind, and you tend to, work around it.
You know
what they are good at, what they are not good at, and you know how to take what they are good at, combine them, and to give the people what they actually want.
Mm. And we are very screw up tolerant.
We screw up.
No, and we are very, very screw up tolerant. Like, you know, we can laugh at our own screw ups, and we are not holding it against anyone. And I think that keeps us going. And like you mentioned, we have tremendous amount of respect for each other.
Yeah.
And we believe that we individually have great strengths as musicians.
Right.
Not everybody have the same kind of strengths. We have pretty unique skills that we individually bring together. That's how our music also ended up to be the same genre that we play, because we didn't enforce individual thinking or psyching to the other person's mind. So I think then coming to your point, lack of money and frustration could be a factor. But I have more often seen people figuring that out by doing odd jobs, like figuring out day jobs, or like, you know, contracting, doing sound. People become sound vendors, people do freelance sound engineering, people go and play for, like, they actually go help out DJs, but still, the predominant band killer is that, like, you know, I don't like to work with you anymore. Mm. That's what kills bands.
And that is very important lesson for all co-founders seeing this right now. You know, staying on that emotional touch that music has, how difficult is it to keep business away from music? Because does it affect, like, having a business angle in music? Does it, like,
you cannot do or sustain a band without having that business angle?
But does that affect the charm of the music?
You talked about Rudra, you liked it so much.
Right.
I told you it's such a crowd pleaser. It's such a sing along. It has such a sing along chorus line. But if you look at it, it has a lot of odd time signatures, it has a lot of intricacies.
Right.
So, I'm not talking business here, but I'm just saying that there is always, you can always package it in a way that it's both entertaining and not really a...
And sometimes also I think, like, you know, leave the business to a guy who's willing to do it.
Hmm.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's almost in all bands, it is a trivial idea. Almost in all successful bands, there will be one guy, or sometimes two guys, who are actually cool dealing with the non-musical aspects.
Mm.
And the same way, there will be the other candidate as well, who just does not want to deal with the business Like, you know, as long as you're paying me for my cigarette and beer, I'll pay. there are two extremes, and I've always seen that it gets balanced out in good, successful balance.
So, when is Agam's manager coming to me?
We'd like to have, I was speaking to a friend of mine who came from IT, so he said something like this, pay me 5% of what you're making a manager.
Okay.
So, see, there's an economics involved there also, like, you know, how much does the bank, how does the bank play a manager? Is it a salary? Is it a cut on the revenue that you make? Or is it like a stipend based system? We do not know, right? So we haven't.
There's no one right answer.
So when are we going to have a manager? We'd like to have one, and we're hoping we'll have one who will actually, like, you know, like our music and understand our music, and also
he's also
passionate about managing this band beyond the money that he's making. Yeah. So we'll see when we get there.
Yeah.
So hopefully we'll get there as well. So the aspiration is definitely there.
Yeah. So, you know, as a concluding note, what's your advice for budding musicians, people who are thinking that they cannot make it in the music industry? You know, how can they make a living out of what they love to do the most?
Your music.
Yeah.
Don't make music for 2.5 years.
Yeah.
Just your asset is, if your asset is just your self-belief, you're doing it very wrong.
Yeah.
Right.
Put out your alphas and betas.
Ask
your music. Is it making sense? How much is it making sense to people? Is it just an underground scene of 50 people? Is it the 500 people? Is your music going viral, or is your music getting terribly criticized? Keep doing that.
Iterate,
fix it. If 50 guys come to a link and say this sucks,
take it.
It is likely that you are stupid and they are not.
Yeah.
And if you're still being a cockhead and is going to say that, like, you know, all these guys are morons, like, you know, they're all Bollywood sellouts, you're stupid. You're not going to. The third one is stick together. It's you're in this together. It's not one person's band. It is everybody's band. Stick together, do your thing. Third is like agree to disagree. Yeah, you cannot always agree on one single thing. All six of you are never going to agree to one thing that you do in the song. It is not going to happen to you. It is not going to happen to you ever.
Right.
So understand that there are certain things left that way. The guy who is adamant about it probably knows what's best for him.
Hmm.
So sometimes have that mutual trust and respect that when somebody is adamant about what he wants to do, maybe give him that space and give him that respect.
Okay.
And move forward. Third one is like make money at all opportunities. Whichever money making opportunities comes your way, take it. Like if it means you bending your core ideologies little, and not if you don't deviate it from too much. Like, for example, unless a punk rock band is playing like, you know, Kishore Kumar, that is an aberration. I am psychedelic progressive doom angsty punk rock. It's a nice niche genre to have. But nobody will use a shit. So play something that makes sense.
Something that interests.
If you're that niche,
play
at the garage. That is your business. But if you're very niche and are expecting actually like an exponential reach and money,
make the music,
you're spying the wrong thing.
Make the music
work your viability. Work your viability. All bands, like, you know, brand me. All the bands watching me, call me a sellout. I don't care. But if your music is not viable, you're just not there.
Hmm.
And it's probably my life's best moments of, you know, that I've spent with you guys.
Thanks so much for having us.
And it's really been great. From a music lover's point of view and from a business angle, this has really been brilliant.
Thank you so much.
Agam had just released their latest album. Harish, you want to take that?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, like I said, any opportunity to self-promote is always taken. Thank you for giving the airtime. However, this that is. We just put out our debut album called The Inner Self Awakens. It's got 6 songs that we recorded through the last 2 years, and we released it on the 11th of October, which happened to be yesterday, as we speak today. And so it is available for digital downloads as of now on this interesting startup called OKListen.com.
Interesting, okay.
Yeah, so it is a new startup, and it is exclusively for independent music. A person called Vijay Basu runs it.
Okay.
And so we have actually chosen OKListen as our exclusive platform at the moment to sell our music. So it is OKListen.com/Agam is where you can buy our album. And considering I spoke about this in the interview, we believe it is very honestly priced at 99 rupees for the whole album and 20 rupees a song. So might be, if you like our music, if you heard us before and like it, go buy our album or buy our singles as the way you like it.
Yeah.
And where do you find one of our music? It's fb.me/agamtheband. So that's facebook.com/agamtheband. We'll move this to the other.
Shankar, Shankar, Mahadev, Har Har.